Any public participation?
Sorry.
Public participation? Okay, seeing none, we're going right to the presentation.
Okay, so for the goals presentation, I know back when my evaluation was done, there was a lot of conversation about setting specific goals and working on specific items that were noted in my evaluation. The two most prominent pieces that came out from my reading of it, and if that's something different from the group, please jump in, was the morale of the building and the academic rigor and where we're going academically. So that's very broad strokes. Over the last couple of weeks, had an opportunity with the administrative team to first really delve into the morale survey and the responses that I shared with everybody about 10 days ago, and really take to heart what was said in that survey, and then looking at how we as the administrative team could, first of all, better support our teachers, and second of all, really work to move the Belvidere School District to a great school district. So I really compliment the team. We've had some what I think are outstanding conversations. I coerced the principals to come up to beautiful Lake Wallenpaupack, where we were away from everybody. We spent 4 hours focused on the Belvidere School District, and it was probably the best 4 hours we've had as a team since pre-COVID, I would say. And at least Jess is raising her hand, so at least one of them agrees. Eric, I'm going to need your help here because this guy's going to not make me happy today. I need to go back. Thank you. You can tell we haven't used the technology since the last week in June, so it's on there. So these were from our takeaways from the again, my number one, my evaluation, number two, from what we read in the morale survey. These were our key takeaways, our key topics. And then again, if after this presentation is there's more needs to be added, please let us know. Number one is key is academic rigor and improvement. Number two is improvement of culture. We're going to stop using the term morale and use the term culture, because I think culture building is more important than, I think morale is a short-term fix, where culture is a long-term fix. So we want to make sure we have a long-term fix. Number three, I think the word accountability was used probably about 11 or 12 times in my evaluation. So I talked about that with the administrative team and our level of accountability, and accountability going basically top-down. I'm accountable to the board. The administrative team is accountable to me. Teachers and staff are accountable to the administrative team, and making sure that the teachers recognize students are accountable to them. So it's that upward mobility. Number four is the use of the word support. We started kicking around the idea, let's help everybody, but helping isn't really what we want to do. We want to support everybody to be their best. And so those are key terms. And number five, and I think this came out a lot in the survey, is the visibility of the administrative team, and that includes me, making sure that we are more visible, and not just standing there visible, but visibly engaging the staff and the students and anybody that is in our building, and making sure that, again, we're supporting their needs. Try this again. Okay. So the first thing is rigor, academic rigor, and I wanted to throw this out there and hopefully get a little discussion out of the board tonight. How do we define academic rigor? If you had to write a quick definition, what would you say?
They're also held accountable, you know,
done by a certain time, this is it. There's no looking back. Because when you get to college, guess what? They're in for a rude awakening. So that's how I would perceive this, to be challenged, pushed, and at all levels. So we want them to succeed. And if they're not pushed, if they're not held accountable, guess what? They're not going to make it out there in the job market.
Anyone else?
Specific point to focus on academically versus, you know, the broader stuff that they've already been going through. So by the time they're juniors, seniors, they know or have some idea of what their future is going to hold, and we're supporting them by giving them the staff and the classes they need to really hone in on what they need to succeed.
Sorry, I think that SEL, because it became such a big topic with COVID, and I'm not saying it's not important, but it's become almost taking over academics. And I think some parents too, I'm not just saying administrators, think it's okay if they just get their kid to school. Like, I want to move past COVID. I want to get to where, no, your kid's in school to learn and to strive for excellence, not just, like, to make it to school when he can, you know? And I know I'm exaggerating, but I really believe that it's not just an issue here. I think it's an issue in a lot of districts that COVID and working on social-emotional learning overtook academics.
I think piggybacking off of what everyone else has already said, for me, academic rigor is having those classes that are so up to date that makes us want to be the hub. Like right now, I know that our agriculture department is doing amazing things. We need to lean into that more and really dig deep. Like, you have so much that you could do, and I know that we've talked about how we would incorporate even just the fields into this. Being able to academically have the agriculture students do bio in a warehouse situation, because that's how things are now progressing, is how do you grow vegetables and everything in a warehouse? And I think we need to bring that here and have that available.
Anybody on this side of the room?
I kind of agree with Jen. I think for COVID, a lot of the kids were given a free pass. Just show up and you're going to pass. And as a matter of fact, in some districts, and I don't know if it was true here, the teachers were told you're not allowed to fail anybody. Mm-hmm. I don't care what you do, they do not fail. So I think that's where we need to get away from COVID. Kids need to come back to class, they need to do the work, need to be held accountable for what they're doing. You know, those kind of things.
I know you want to say
that. Turn your mic on.
It looked like you wanted to.
Question that, you know, comes up in job all the time, but for me, academic rigor is not only setting academic challenges for children, but putting the right supports in successful environment, and also striving that any child, no matter their ability or their disability, has that ability to learn and be excellent.
It's interesting. So we were kicking this idea around. I put a slideshow together for the administrative team, and I had a bunch of open-ended questions, and I asked them to fill it in over the course of from when we met about 2 weeks ago to tonight. And I won't say which administrator said it, but I think said it well, that we've gotten to the point where we're teaching to the slowest ship, and everybody else is not being challenged above that. So that's sort of we've hit that waterline. And I thought that was an excellent statement. And I agree with that. And one of the things we talked about in our meeting was non-negotiables. What is becoming non-negotiable for us as an administrative team? Number one is, as you said, Mr. Ty, not accepting work that's late. You know, Mr. Carabinas has the idea, and it's going to put into effect, where he's going to have an opportunity period during lunch. Kid doesn't do their schoolwork, homework. They're going to come sit during lunch, and they're going to do their work. And that's going to be that expectation. And in the high school, we talked about there's cutoff times, and that's it. And we have to be the ones to follow up on that. And I think I agree with what you said, Mrs. Scott, about it's time for COVID to be over. We know COVID is probably realistically never going to be over at this point. But from an educational point of view, we need to go back to doing the things the basics to get our kids where they need to be. And it's interesting that we talk again a little bit today. You know, we, and then it comes to number two, how do you measure improvement? You know, we talk about standardized tests, and specifically the SLA testing, the NJSLA testing, but the state is going to have us do the Start Strong test again come September, which, in my opinion, means that the state of New Jersey saw those major gaps. Most of them were not filled in, and so now we're going to go back and look and see if those gaps still exist, you know, not just holding on to the SLA testing. So how will we measure improvement? So I think that when that becomes part of a board goal, you know, for the superintendent that we're going to have academic improvement, how do we measure that? Is it only standardized tests, or is it beyond that? Not a rhetorical question.
I would like to see something measured in the fact of maybe decreasing the percentage of students that are falling below grade level. So that can give a bigger picture. It doesn't have to be just based off of standardized testing. We have enough that we can figure out what grade level they're at, and there's a number, and we decrease it by a certain percentage by the end of the school year. I think that would be a great goal.
I think, and I know there's a lot of, when I talk about school scores and things like that, I think there needs to be that balance between fixed mindset and goal mindset. And if we had a stronger goal mindset with these students, I think it would surpass the standardized testing. So I would love to see more of that be brought in and see where we're at.
Love that idea. We one of the things we talked about as a team was, and I think for sure for the last 2 years and probably even before that, we had the fixed mindset. Like, let's just fix the SEL. Let's just fix the holes. And one of the things we talked about was 1 and 3 year goals. So what are the goals for this year? And like what Mrs. Constantino said is a perfect goal for this year. But what are we looking for at the end of 3 years? So, and I said to the team, like you said it well, Ms. Kennedy, we can't fix everything in 1 year. But if we have those goals where we want our students to be in 3 years, I think that's very, very, very much attainable. And the way we've been, our discussions have been over the last couple of weeks, I think we've gotten beyond that. Let's just fix the problem and then hope that it doesn't come up again. But reality is that we know that it pretty much just comes right back up rather than long-term. Anybody else want to jump in on that?
Well, and I know curriculum notes aren't out yet, but in the meeting you guys talked the other night about, too, even evaluating students more regularly and how some classes were only getting a few grades posted, so it was hard to keep track of who might be slipping through because they had a grade here and then they had a grade posted halfway through the marking period and not. So we had talked about making that more ability to be able to see throughout the whole marking period instead of just trying to play catch up at the end. I think that was a great idea. And even like with our high school kids, the systems with looking at grades now and being more on top of that instead of just letting, you know, the end of the season kind of slide by and keeping on them right till final testing done, I think is going to be a big help too.
Anybody else?
I think if we have a lot of rigor happening, we're going to see increased enrollment in the AP and CP courses. Does that make sense? So if we see that in 3 years, those courses are doubling their numbers, we know that we're doing something right below that. You know, that we have the correct goal to lead us into getting those kids more advanced classes.
And I think it's a great point, too. And one of the things we talked about, too, was quality over quantity. So if we do get those increased students in those AP courses and those CP courses, making sure that they're also performing at the level that we have as a level of expectations. You know, we go back probably 5 or 6 years ago in our AP classes, we had great participation. You know, we'd have 23 kids in our AP psych class, and two of them would get 4 or 5. And, there, you know, 20 would get ones. And you're going, okay, that's great that you had 20 kids in the class, but if they can't perform at the level, we shouldn't have them in the class. And I think that's very good.
It's going to sound off the wall, but is it possible to address on how, and I'm not saying our teachers are bad or anything, but how teachers are teaching and their approach in teaching with the students, because maybe it's there, you know, there's some students that connect with teachers and some that don't, but maybe the style, how they approach it, because I think that is something to look at as well. I don't know how you could measure that, but maybe look at something and try to implement it across the board on style, technique, so on and so forth. So I'm just throwing that out there.
Yeah, so
I don't know.
Hold that thoughts. I think a little bit later we're going to kind of address that, because I think we have something that's where we're going. I think we're
okay.
I don't know if it's going to directly hit it, but I think we're on that.
Touching on things, like, think about it. Some of the incoming freshmen, you know, like these kids are jumping into high school and they're not prepared on how to pace themselves. So like a pace guide, like you have to do a rough draft by this date. You know, we have to go backwards a little bit and reteach the basics that.
Yeah, because I
and
even
the support for the kids that need that.
I even think back at going backwards, because I mean, even with English, you don't see diagramming a sentence anymore. And I think that's one of the biggest things that I benefited from, because I was not the best with writing English, and you don't see things like that anymore. And I think too, with a lot of the students, I'm not saying a lot of the students, but I am an employer, and I do hire high school students, college students, and one of the biggest things that I see too that is missing is problem solving. They don't know how to solve a problem. So even with something that like that implemented within the whole school, within the system, in the approach of teaching, would help them and benefit them going forward. So I just put it out there. Sorry.
I was just going to say something about attendance in general. I mean, that's measurable too. I mean, if we're looking at percentage goals, I think that's always an issue. It's actually
and
affected
tardiness.
Us on standardized tests in the past, but obviously more than standardized tests, it's if kids aren't here, they're not learning. They're not
definitely
not being rigorous. So.
And tardiness too.
And tardy, yeah. The tardies are ridiculous.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
To Doug's point, and I know that Ms. McKinney and I talked a little bit about this in the other room, can we break out, even if it's just in the first week, to have maybe a problem solving and how to study in the first week before you really jump into this new academic rigor? These kids have no idea how to study, and I think that would be super beneficial. I know a few other schools, they take 2 weeks. That's all that they do is problem solving, learn how to study, and then they start. And I know 2 weeks is a long time, but it might be beneficial for the kids.
Time management, too.
Note taking.
I think, just to kind of touch on some of the points, and if you're in curriculum, and then the curriculum notes will go out on Saturday, look for your emails on Saturday. One of the things that was a part of that was both Mr. Bartow and Mr. Carabinas put together a very updated discipline policy where tardies and absences is absolutely addressed in very specifically. Actually, to be very fair, Mr. Bartow's plan is excellent, and it's extremely detailed. And I think that's something that we need to put back in place. And again, it goes back to the level of accountability, though, right? We can have the greatest discipline policy in the world, but if we don't enforce it, and we're not following up and holding the kids and the staff accountable, it's no better than the worst one in the world. So I think that was really well done. But that'll come out. You'll get to see that. In fact, I think you sent it to the staff this morning, too, right, Mr. Bartow? So I just threw this on, and I think we kind of hit all that, you know, for rigor, opportunities for students to go beyond what is taught in the classroom. Opportunities for what students learn to be applied to real life situations. I think that's sort of where you were. There was some going with You're talking about the FFA and you know, growing plants and even some of the problem solving. Students need to feel supported and challenged at the same time. I heard that also. We believe as an administrative team that culture and academic rigor are strongly connected. It's not the end all be all between those two connections, but if there's not a strong academic feeling in the building, that we think that had a huge impact on the morale last year, and it certainly was noted in the morale survey multiple times. I think one teacher just wrote back, academics, 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 bring back academics. And then that idea of working towards individualized instruction, recognizing that not every kid learns at the same pace, not every student is going to have the same goals, and how can we best service every student and support them in all their endeavors, and again, not moving as fast as the slower ship. Thought that was an excellent comment. So again, with culture, the biggest piece is, and I think again, and I'm pretty confident from the comments that most of you, if not all of you, read through that morale survey, and it just felt like there was a lack of support from the administrative team to the teacher. I think that was a very common theme. And that goes back to what we talked about as a team, the visibility, making sure that when we do see we're out there, it's not just standing there or us having our conversation, but making sure that the teacher's needs are heard and met. And I think we're all extremely capable of doing that. And the administrative team needs to be supported by me. And one of the questions that I asked them was, what can I do to support you more? And they were all maybe brutally honest, I would say, in what I could do, but it was very, you know, very appropriate and agreed with a lot of it. And I will share the slideshow with the board, too, so you can just kind of see. There's some more, you know, just quick things that we went through, but then you can kind of take a look at what we said. But we're still working on it, so we have a few things we want to fill in first. We'll send that to you. So that's what we want to do. We want to make sure that, if nothing else, the teachers, when they walk in this building, feel supported by us in every way possible. And that's, I think, that we've got away from that with COVID, I think. And it's not just here. Having interviewed upwards of 20 candidates for principal position in my other 40% position, everybody we interviewed talked about the low morale in their buildings at that point. So it's not just here. But that doesn't mean we're just going to ignore it. That means we're going to do the best we can to solve it. Anything on that? Anybody want to add? Culture? Yeah, and I kind of hit on this before, the measuring academic success. So I think there was, yes, standardized test scores are important, but they aren't the end-all be-all. We are going to continue to focus on the skills as well, especially K to 8. I've said it before, I've said it before COVID. If the students aren't getting the foundation in those younger grades, it's almost impossible to think that they're going to pick them up at the end. It's the old, if you're building a house and your foundation is only 60%, chances are by the time you put the roof on, it's going to fall. So we want to make sure we go back and we look at that, and I think that's where Linkit is one of our biggest allies right now, because we can really focus on that. And we're going to talk to the teachers about back-to-school nights, making sure the parents are aware of what we're looking for, skill-specific, when they come in. And then look across cross-grade skills improvement in the client. I think that's kind of where you were going too, Mrs. Constantino, just looking and seeing how the students did from third to fourth, fourth to fifth, and then I know, Marianne, we've talked about that for a lot of years, about how to look at all the way through. So we will continue to do that and report back out on that. These are sort of like the question marks. Is there, again, a quantifiable, you know, do we say we want to see 10%? I don't know. Something that I don't know, we just settled this very second, but when I send this out in a bigger form, what are we looking for? So when we regroup, this was late May when you did my evaluation, we know what those are going to be. Comments on that? So our main focus is as a team, we've discussed this a couple of times, for this coming school year, high expectations for all to be our best each and every day that we walk in here. If I'm my best when I walk in, they'll be their best. And if they're their best when they walk in, the teachers will be their best, and if the teachers are their best, the kids will be their best. It's a simple concept, but we can easily do it. And giving the energy that we all have and we know that we can bring to the building each and every day. And when we had this conversation, there was nobody going, you know, maybe on a random Tuesday, I'm not going to be my best. We're all in on this. We all slugged through the last 2 years in a lot of ways, and we're ready to get back come August 29th as strong as we've been. Improve visibility. I will be at least half of the day every time I'm here. I'll be up in the athletic office. I'll take over there to get myself more visibility. Been trying to kick Eric out of one of his offices, but, you know, it's I won't go down that road. Improve the observations, post-observations meeting. This was I think, the topic where you were talking about the teachers. One of the things that we've done when it comes to observations is everybody's had a somewhat of a different method of how they've observed the staff. We will be meeting right before school starts, and we are going to have common themes that when we observe staff, we will all be looking for. So if I walk into Ms. Steffen's class, I'm going to be looking for something, and then Mr. Bartow follows up 2 weeks later, he's going to be looking for the same things. And it's going to be focus on academic rigor, focus on accountability, and then we're going to go through the Danielson model, and we're going to pick out certain things that we think are very important. The other thing is I will increase my level of observations this year to take some of the burden off of the team. That's something that I've tried to do, and I'm going to be very focused on doing that too. And we're also going to divide it by department. So it doesn't matter, K to 12, I'll have math. So I'll be looking at the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade math teachers as well. I'll go into the elementary and the high school. Mr. Carabinas will have social studies, and he'll be doing the same thing. Doesn't matter that he's only the elementary principal. And obviously Ms. McKinney, Ms. Bartow as well. So really be consistent and then work with that articulation, so making sure that we're all on the same page. Again, quality of instruction over quantity of instruction. We have increased time in the middle school, or really K to 8, but mostly middle school, ELA and math. But we want to make sure with that extra time that the teachers are getting, that it's quality time. So there's going to be extra time to read 15 pages of The Outsiders. We want to make sure at the end of that 15 pages that there are 5 or 6 extremely challenging questions that the kids have to answer. And the teachers are getting the feedback from the students rather than read this and then we'll see it at the end of the day. And again, finally, our updated discipline policies, as I said before, the team did an outstanding job of getting those in place. I think when you see those policies and the point system and everything that's together, I think you'll be very impressed and proud of the work that they did. I know I am. So I appreciate that. So those are our 5 main focuses, what we're going to be looking at on a daily basis. And I just left it blank for any other goals. So. On the policies.
I'm a firm believer.
Would you guys like to jump in and just real quick comment on what the new policies are?
I did the notes, but you're not going to get them on till Saturday. So Saturday. Brad can give you a little bit of a glimpse.
The year and get started with all this. Accountability stuff. So the plan is we have pocket charts in all the classrooms, but this year they will be used. The kids will walk in, they will put their phones up for the entirety of the period. And then at the end of the period, when the bell rings, they can grab it, leave, they can use their phone during passing time, lunch, and study hall at the moment. But those are the only times that they're going to be using their phone. Again, a kid's going to walk in and say, well, I didn't have my phone, it's at home or got taken away. Well, that's fine. If we don't see it, it's not a problem. If it is, going to be under the discipline policy. I forget. First time's 5 points and a warning, and the teacher confiscates it for the period. Second time, I confiscate it for the day, give it back to him at the end of the day. It's 10 points. Third time, so on and so forth. Again, you'll see did you send the discipline points yet? Okay, so you'll get that on Saturday, but everything, and if you get 30 points, this happens. 60 points, this happens. 100 points, 150.
Very specific. Like attendance, tardiness, everything you can think of is addressed within that policy. We also talked about our student athletes and following the NJSIA policy like we always have, but adding that, I know that was a complaint of mine, an additional layer of every 2 weeks guidance, running a report, any student that has a 60 or below in any given class, that report will go to the coach. The coach then will meet with the student. That student's not playing for 2 weeks. So it's not as, because the way the guidelines read now, if they have a certain number of credits, you know, they can play that sport, but they could be tanking while the sport's happening. So just all of these things that we talked about in curriculum are really, like, I'm feeling really good about it as far as Chris's goals with morale and a lot of the issues that were presented with the survey are being addressed in all these these policies that we have in place.
And I know policy, the cell phone one and the athletics probably going to have to change.
Certain like big ticket items like a fifth and eighth grade field trip, you get a suspension, you earn your three, you can't because go for an overnight trip. We're not going to have any gray area there. That's why we're going to use our behavior coaches for individual behavior plans to earn points back, but they're designed by students with facilitation of behavior coaches. So we have a pretty clear cut.
My only feedback on this. And then I didn't want to move forward if anybody moved forward, but the second goal that you open up and you say, well, you know, it's open for anybody's ideas, I think it needs to be around improvement of the building, which includes the fields. You know, we talked about an action plan for, you know, 3 years. Maybe this incorporating, you know, the facility as well, and maybe other ideas. And again, the goal will be improvement. How do we measure that improvement, and then what the action plan will be to achieve those goals?
So facility upgrades, yes, seeing those things be done, because that was mentioned in a few surveys.
Also add in cybersecurity. Unfortunately, our family had a dose of this a little bit harder than a lot of others. Being able to sit on Quora during tests or in their education with their teachers. A lot of predators can get to these kids in ways that I didn't even know was possible. You have teachers using Pinterest for academic reasons. You have predators coming in to their messaging boxes. And I know this is something that we had talked about as a group during evaluations, was why is it that these kids have carte blanche to emailing outside of the school district? People can email in to their emails. That should not be, in my personal opinion. Everything YouTube doesn't need to be in classrooms. If there are ways to pull off YouTube videos into a specific screen. Having better lockdowns, so while there is actual instructional teaching, no one's on their computers, flip of a switch, they go off. I think it has to happen, because I will tell you from my experience, you guys as a school, we're sitting on a lawsuit of child endangerment, and we better nip it right now.
I think in the past, a goal may have been along the terms of communication. We spent a lot of time talking about that, and I want to, you know, commend you that we've gotten so much better in terms of communication, the infographics, the all calls,
mm-hmm.
you know, putting interviews, I mean, job openings on Facebook. You know, I think that that has improved tremendously. So you know, I'm glad that that doesn't need to be a goal.
I'm with I forget who said it, but I need to see some actual measurable goals. Are we going to increase test scores by 5%, by 50%, by 3%? Are we going to increase attendance, which I think is critical, by 5% or 20%? I think we need to knock down some numbers on these, really lock it in.
Well, I think, too, at every meeting, we set aside a specific time to go through as a group. Where we are with these goals, what we've done, what we have accomplished, so on and so forth, and where what we else we need to do going forward. I would kind of like to see a timeline of what the future looks like. You know, this is what we plan to do in September going forward, and then you know, we roll with it. I mean, this is important. This is very important. So, and also, thank you, because not everyone would have done what you did here tonight, to stand up
mm-hmm.
and to talk about it. And I think it's important that we're talking about it, because we need to move forward. You know, this is a great school. Great people within it, and I think discussing this openly helps us moving forward. All of us.
I agree.
So thank you.
I also commend my team too. Mm-hmm.
Yes, thank you.
We had a pretty open conversation when we talked about it. It was, you can defend it as you want, but we have to improve on it. And if we don't want to face it, we're never going to improve. And I think that's the point that I agree.
Right. Yeah. You know. We all have shortcomings, and to be able to recognize, hey, you can't, there's no way you could possibly do everything. There's no way. But you just do your best, and you're honest about it, and we're going forward. So.
And we have to improve as board members ourselves.
Yes,
you know, I think that we're, you know, making great strides as a group, but I think that we all can do, you know, we have to point our fingers this way, too. You know, it shouldn't just be pointed at you. How could we all help support? And that's kind of what I was saying to you the other day, Mr. Bartow, about the parents. You know, like, parents might see the discipline policy and really come at teachers hard or you or the administrators or even you. And you all have to know that it's supported by the board. So the parents, the one thing about Belvidere, because we're so small, and I think this has been the culture for even before you were here, positive about Belvidere is parents are very comfortable with us. You know, they'll come in, I'm not talking about board, I'm talking with you. Mr. Carabinas, how many times do parents come talk to you just, you know everyone. And I think that that's great. And they don't always come with complaints. Sometimes they just want to chat. But because we have such an open door policy, they feel that they can call and complain about anything. And you guys have been so over accommodating that it's getting to the point where things are getting lost now. Like, we don't even know what, because we're trying to accommodate this situation,
but then this parent sees that it, you know, they didn't get as much discipline. We can't be afraid of parents, and you have to know that you're supported by us. In the end, you're following board policy. So
that, I just wanted to add that.
And maybe we can incorporate updates like every 2 months or 3 months, however you want to.
Every meeting.
Every meeting update.
As part of the superintendent report, if there's anything in addition. Yeah.
That's a discussion, yeah.
Okay.
Put it on the agenda.
Okay.
Put it as a standing thing?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them, I mean, I know it's hard to measure certain things, but things like attendance can easily be measured from 1 year to another. And I'm curious to see how the new stricter policy, you know, by June, it look at our June 23 versus our June 22 and how much better did we get. So those kinds of things can be measured at least.
Absolutely.
Our discipline infractions, you know, how many did they go down?
I have a little tiny concern. So we're talking about change of policy that is going to take place now. And my question is, have we done the first reading of the policy?
We're working on that. Yeah, we'll have those ready for hopefully for the 24th meeting, first reading, full approval on the 20th. Keep in mind that when it comes to discipline, discipline is not quote unquote policy that exists, it's in the handbook. So that can be
approved in the handbook.
Okay, I'm just concerned to make sure that we follow process,
right,
because if there's a change in policy, the first reading is for the board, the second reading is to give the public the opportunity to raise their hand if there is concern about anything that might be missing, and then it gets approved and then it gets implemented. So I want to make sure that we're following process. If you're saying that it's an exception because it's within the handbook, that's fine. I just want us to be cautious of that.
And we approve the handbook, right?
Not formally.
We don't?
No. We send copies and then we send the questions.
Are you sending it out?
Like highlight.
In that way.
I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. How are we going to communicate these changes to the parents? Parents are not typically used to reading these handbooks any longer.
Get it electronically. Get it electronically.
You just electronically sign it.
how the opening, when I looked the other day, wasn't in Genesis yet. Because I was wondering when the all call goes out, that the forms are now available and the emails go out, can we even just put a big thing saying, please read, there has been.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. 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 All the technology, all the pickup changes for the elementary school, all that. Yeah, when that goes out, if we can just highlight saying, you know, that there's been changes made, because how many people just click through them every year and just don't even sign them? I'm sure plenty of them. Yeah. Yeah, it's in the athletic one. When you sign off, it asks you those same things. Like, one of the links is, you know, the state things to follow, and then the other one's the school one. Yeah. Yep, there's links that you could go in and read them if you wanted to. No, I looked, they weren't. Yeah, the only one I got from the high school was the one saying you had to sign for the athletic one, that form, if you had any athlete, you know, for the upcoming season.
I don't think so. Anybody have anything else? No, that's okay. Any other comments, questions? I mean, these goals will be pressing because we'll talk about them every meeting, then we'll just be revisiting and.
The only thing I have is two questions that came up from the whole presentation. One was the, you know, not teaching to the slowest ship, which I think is great for those kids, but how do we support the slowest ship from there?
Yeah, I think in the general sense, you're talking about that, not in the specific sense. And I think there's one thing that we do well is we do have those supports for our special needs students, for sure. I just think when you're thinking of a general classroom.
That's what I'm thinking, yeah, in
that
general
sure
classroom,
that
those five
you realize
kids.
That you have students that are high achievers, and I think as we started with, making sure they're challenged too,
yep.
But at the same time recognizing the students that need that extra boost and giving them that extra boost.
Yeah.
That's basically where we're going to. Is going to be, you know,
yeah,
down the road, it's individualized learning.
We're looking at our sports kids every 2 weeks saying, who's got 60s? But what about those kids that aren't playing sports? You know, who's saying who's got 60s in here because they can't keep up, you know, and how are we supporting them is just my next part to that. And then the other one, you were talking about Linkit, which I still think is great. How we have talked about this in the Linkit meeting way back when for the five of us that showed up. Have we figured out how do we encourage the kids to do well and try their best on it? That was, I know, a big thing, especially in the high school we were talking about. Is it worth it? Is it not? Are these kids just saying, well, it doesn't count if it's anything? Are we trying? So how do we fix that point so we can use Linkit even better?
Yeah. So just real quick, and I think your point's well taken, but I know specific teachers in the high school made it a grade.
Yeah.
You know, plain and simple. You know, if you're not going to do well on this, then it's going to affect your grade overall. And I think we saw a better response in that third form because of that. And I know even in 8th grade, I'm thinking it did the same thing as well. So I think across the board, we're going to make sure that it becomes.
Yeah, because I know you're talking about trying to make a continuity between mm-hmm. classrooms, and I think that's one that we should we should work on if we're going to continue to use it, especially at the high school level, because, yeah, while it's not going to necessarily hurt you, how is it something that we can necessarily use to better everybody?
Yeah. It's good, you know, just to piggyback off that, too, because it just clicked in my head as you said that. And I'm not sure if we talked about this because we haven't met since June, but the governor took away all the testing requirements to graduate for this current class also. And I would anticipate for the class of 24 as well, although it's not been said yet. So you can kind of see where that tidal wave of testing is going. And I think that's why I'll speak for myself, but we like Linkit because it's very tangible now for each individual student. We can look at them, you know, because during this year we'll now have 3 years of data on that. So good points.
And In our school, we do, for that same reason, we don't have Linkit, but we have diagnostic assessments. And part of our grade book has to be, I think it's 15%, is diagnostic assessment. So the kids see that it's definitely a grade every time. I count IXL as a grade. You know, I count things like Linkit as a grade. But in the end, especially for students who really are trying but really are struggling, you don't want to kill them. It's only 15%. But they need to see that number. So if there's a way we can look at that, and I agree that it should be not just this math teacher that's counting it as a grade. You know, I got lucky because this one didn't. They all need to. Every ELA, every math.
Agree.
Are there any, one of my employees years ago said something about and I don't know whether it still exists or not, and I've pushed my other son to find out, but any way that they can earn credits at community college, like take a class at community college?
Yeah, we have a ton, like, of, I mean, I don't want to say a ton, but...
Mm-hmm. Is there a way to let us parents know exactly?
Because I would eyes be are pushing. Raising put that out. Doctor, I'm sorry, Dr. McKinney. Keep going, Ms. McKinney.
I'd be pushing but, that yeah. more, you know, and I'm kicking
so,
myself
so, so
now.
So the short answer is yes. So we'll just make sure the parents are aware of that again. I think it's probably over the 2 years of the COVID. I think that's gotten away from that, but maybe that's even an infographic we send out to the parents. So and it's not just juniors and seniors. You could take classes freshmen. Yeah. I mean, we have quite
it's a in
few.
The curriculum thing for guidance, but you really have to read through to find them.
Yeah.
like you do.
Well, I think too, if we focused on that to push the students to strive, that may be a way, because then again, they're saving. They may walk out of here with a whole year under their belt. So yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, not now.
Whatever came about looking at the VHS or the where the kids were able to hop on the videos? What is that program?
Oh,
Extended Learner.
The Parent University?
No, it was VHS, but then we were looking at a new program.
Contract's done, right?
Oh, VHS.
Oh,
yeah, sorry.
VHS.
Yes.
Yeah, right now we're not working with VHS. We're trying to work with proximity learning, similar idea. They were going to send me a quote. I haven't gotten anything from them, by the way. I don't know if you have, Dr. McKinney.
I mean, I wrote down culture of excellence, rigor, and facility upgrades in general, and what they are definitely tied together. I think it could be separated, though.
I think
it could
be separated, too, because I think you...
I think as far as culture goes, I mean, we're talking about behavior, we're talking about attendance, we're talking about teachers feeling supported. As far as rigor goes, we're talking about the actual academics. So,
and we have an ongoing facility plan still, correct? Because
that
laid out multiple years.
Yeah.
So if we could just add that,
mm-hmm.
so that
that
we
could be a continuation from
it's
last year's goal, turn it into more of an updated goal.
Yeah.
Take out some of the stuff that we know we've accomplished and put new goals into that. That's
because some of it was money, which years we would do. So that might be something to add on to look at.
Correct, yeah. Right. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, and I think the point was, and I thought I read it in evaluation, where there was the one goal, but there was 10 different things under it. So it's really 10 different goals, right? And then even with the facilities plan, there was probably 4 or 5 under that. So rather than they really were 2 goals, while there were 2 overarching goals, there was a lot to that. So this is more, I don't want to say shortening it up. I don't want to make it sound like we're making it easier, but this is more concise. 2 goals, here's how we're going to reach the 2 goals, or really 3 if you count the facilities. Mm-hmm. 3 goals, and this is how we're going to reach them. And put in measurable things along the way.
And the action plan will be revisited every month during the superintendent report. So what have we done as far as, you know, culture or rigor? And it doesn't have to be long, just so that we're constantly all. And I think it's good. I don't think we should have more than 3 goals. I think we all need to have them memorized and not say, well, what goal was it?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mission statement. It's nowhere to be found.
Yep.
So... you know, that's something I know at our board meetings, it's always read. It's always on our agenda. It should also be somewhere visible on the website, one of the first things that you see, because that's ultimately our mission. That's why we're here. That's why this school exists. So I think that we need to address that.
Right. And it's, yeah, we read it at every Harmony board meeting. I will share it, send out with everybody. I'll add it to my list of things to share. We did a strategic planning probably about 4 years ago now. It was definitely a year or so before COVID. We rewrote the mission statement. I actually think it's quite good, to be honest with you, but you're right, it's nowhere to be seen. So maybe that's something we incorporate into our meetings too.
Anything else? Thanks, everybody, for coming, and especially it was an additional meeting. Yes, we have to do another public note. Nope.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn. Second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.